Okay. Just a brief introduction about the course objective. A very broad introduction to Earth observation. And of course, then we will go in details with the multispectral satellite, the main characteristic, the one we need for if we want for Landcover classification. An understanding of the use and purpose of this. In particular, for this first presentation, I'm going to talk about why the Earth observation sector has become so important. I will mention, I cannot not mention the Copernicus program and the Sentinel satellite. Probably you already heard about this. Then I will go in details about multispectral satellite data, so the data we use for Landcover mapping, and the processing itself, the pre-processing. So something that regardless of Google Earth Engine, we have to do before any Landcover classification. So very broadly, Earth observation is essentially any type of technique of gathering information from the planet using remote sensing. So it cannot be just satellite, but it can be anything else from drones to airborne survey. So essentially we have two broad. I will try to be quick during this presentation because I think that most of you know already these things, but eventually if someone doesn't, this can be useful. So we have a broad classification in active and passive sensor. Passive, of course, the one on the left, they use the usually most of the time the energy reflected from the sun, so the electromagnetic spectrum, which is produced, the energy produced from the sun and reflected from the surface, but it can be also energy emitted from the surface for hot bodies, for example. Or active sensor, which we are not going to use now, where essentially they produce their own source of energy. And this is very important because this means that they can acquire also during night. So there is no sun condition restriction. So as you can see, part of the energy of the sun is reflected. So this is the energy we are going to use for doing our Landcover map with multispectral satellite. They are passive sensor, but as I told you, there are also energy which is naturally emitted from bodies with a hot temperature. Will not be the case for our course, and part of the energy is also absorbed. The relationship. So as you can see here, in particular, this energy reflected for the passive reflector is not just the visible ground band, but it encompasses a wide range of wavelengths, which goes from, you can see the ultraviolet to essentially the radar wavelengths. But of course, these are essentially the visible band, so between 400 and 700 nanometers, so 0.4 micrometers and 0.7 micrometers are the most important for Landcover mapping. So it's where most of the essentially objects have distinctive characteristics. And as you can see, most of these, if we see the energy here versus the wavelength, as you can see, most of this energy is essentially energy reflected by the sun and emitted by the sun and reflected by surface. But if we go, for example, here in what is called a thermal infrared, most of the energy reflected by the sun, by the Earth, it's so small that essentially here, most of the spectrum is dominated by essentially energy emitted by hot bodies. But this will not be the case in our course. So as you can see, we have different name for sensor according to the type of energy we analyze. So as you can see, we have LiDAR data. Usually they use energy from the visible and near infrared. They usually are active. They are always active reflector. The same for radar. They use microwave. But for us, in our case, we need to look at the multi and hyper multispectral, the purple one, which have spectrum, which analyze the electromagnetic waves between the visible near infrared and thermal infrared. And they are passive sensors. And as you can see, one of the drawbacks of multispectral satellites is, of course, that most of the information is carried in the visible spectrum, which means that the atmosphere transmissivity is very, very dependent of weather conditions. So whenever there is clouds, we cannot essentially get any information from the surface, the Earth surface. Differently, for example, microwave, they don't are not affected by weather condition. So it means that essentially, even with cloud coverage, we can acquire data. So of course, this is important because it means that, for example, for any radar acquisition, we can always get information from the surface, but for multispectral, this cannot be the case in case of very cloudy environment, like for example, the Great Britain climate. And this is just to give you, let's say a range of resolution and timing of acquisition. So as you can see, satellite data, the one we are going to use, they usually have acquisition time of days, weeks, and years ago, it was also revisiting time for satellite was of months. So it means for the same area, if you want, it's particularly important, this information for if we want to do length cover changes, because let's consider we were trying to do length cover changes 10 years ago, we would have probably a satellite acquisition every month. It means that essentially we have less information for the same time span. And second, the probability of having cloudy coverage for that only acquisition in a month, for example, is more likely. But of course, the benefit of using airborne, unmanned aerial vehicle, or mobile, for example, is that, of course, the acquisition time, revisiting time is much higher. So they can acquire more information in the same time. And also the resolution is better. But of course, there is a drawback in this. First is the cost, because airborne and drone survey, they are more expensive for the same area covered than satellite data. And second, the coverage itself, the footprint. We should consider that usually with satellite data, we are able to do regional analysis in one, with one image. So we can cover 1,000 of square kilometers. And you can see how satellite data are now leading the Earth observation world. This is just a graph showing, and it's not updated, it's going through 2013. You can see from the launch of the first artificial satellite in the end of the 50s, you can see we have a steady increase of the total, the cumulative number of launches. We have now more than 5 times. These are just the civilian, okay, launch. So there is a much higher number if we consider military ones. As you can see, you will notice that essentially, as of 2013, more than 5,000 satellites have been launched. And today we should consider that the number of launches here has diminished. It's not because essentially there are less satellites now compared than before. It's just because satellites last longer. So it means, yeah, you don't need to regularly launch a new one once the previous mission has ended. And also, usually now satellite tends to be smaller, so they can be sent to the orbit with the same rocket. Usually we have one rocket, a carrier, which bring several, multiple satellites together. So this explains the steady decrease. Today, we have around 1,000 active satellites of any kind of use, and only 15% of them, so a very small, small component, is designed to do Earth observation acquisition. So we should consider most of, probably half of these satellites, they are used for meteorological observation. So why it's so important? Because of course, data, we will see that most of the time are easily downloadable and for free. This is the main point. We have multi-decade imagery. So if something happened now, we can, for a part of the world, we luckily we can go back and see if there were sign of, for example, a landslide failure before, years ago. So we can do retrospective studies. Compared to other remote sensing platform, they are time saving and cost efficient solution. Because yeah, we can acquire we can cover 1,000 of square kilometers of area with one image. It's a non-invasive analysis, so this is very important where there could be problem in remote areas for accessing the site, or also if for political reason we cannot have access permission to specific area. As I told you before, especially for some sensor, especially in the microwave region, there is no essentially cloud cover problem, weather restriction. And in that case, for active sensor in general, we have both a day and night operational capability. For our multispectral satellite, we are of course limited at daily diurnal observation. And usually they are around 11 a.m. in the morning, because historically satellite have been acquiring at that time of the day. So this would make easier any correlation with different sensor. There is now a wide range of application of Earth observation for different sectors. So from land and coastal monitoring. I'm thinking about agriculture, forestry. They are very important because we can collect information about land change over time, mining monitoring. So to especially for area which are prone to, for example, coastal erosion, or for monitoring sea condition, for example, in case of oil spills, atmosphere. In particular, if for weather events, specific weather events, or for example, the temperature of the atmosphere or presence of pollution in it. Security, because there is a surveillance also done with satellite data, in particular, for example, to monitoring borders and sea roads across the border. Climate change, of course, because satellite, in particular for climate change, satellite are the only sensor who can provide a world, a planet scale observation. And also emergency situation. So, because sometimes satellite can acquire soon after, especially commercial provider can supply satellite data soon after in the aftermath of a disaster. And you have probably seen some of the over the last few years, BBC news, which essentially works, reported in BBC, where essentially satellite images have provided a huge benefit in a specific event. You can see the burning of Myanmar village, this refugee village, I think in Asia. Then we have wildfire in France, detection of earthquake motion with radar satellite, or you can see here oil spill and flooding. So as you can see, these satellite have already are still currently providing useful information in our daily life. And this has been possible essentially over the last few years. So this is something that it's very important we are doing now. Just because before didn't have the same capabilities. And this is just to give you an idea of, in particular, the program I'm going to talk about, the size of the program. So essentially, we are going to use satellite provider from the European Space Agency. I'm comparing now the size of three of the main satellite essentially institution, satellite related institution. You well know NASA, and as you can see, they have a budget which is much higher of ESA, so of an entire continent. And of course, inevitably, the UK Space Agency also considered the latest political development as a budget, which might change, but still it's consistently smaller than the European Space Agency. However, if we, this is the budget of the whole programs they have, so even including spatial extraterrestrial exploration. So if we consider just the Earth observation program, these numbers are quite similar. So if we compare the European Space Agency with NASA, so essentially they invest the same amount of money in Earth observation program. We are talking probably, I don't remember now exactly the exact figures, but we are talking about probably about 1 billion of this budget of ESA is dedicated to Earth observation, which is the same amount of budget dedicated by NASA for the same purpose. So this is just to say that we are working with one of the best Earth observation program in the world, if not the best. And as you can see, just the this Earth observation program from the European Space Agency has already provided, these are number up, which are updated to 1 year ago, so will still now be higher. As you can see, we have more than a quarter of a million people, almost a quarter of a million people who have used this data through the official ESA links. So there is a much higher number of people, for example, who are using this European Space Agency data through Google Earth Engine will not be reported here. As you can see, have been downloaded more than 140 petabytes of data. More than 60 million of products have been published using data from the European Space Agency, from the Earth Observation Program of ESA. And as you can see also, the number product published, I think these are, I don't remember now this number, probably they are in the last month. Or on this day, the 20th of May, you could see that more than essentially and tens of thousands of products are published and downloaded every day. And this is has also a reflection and impact also in number of papers. This is a whole paper in 2017. As you can see, the number of papers, this is just considering a specific technique called INSA. As you can see, the number of papers published has increased steadily just because there is more data available, which allows us to do more things, essentially. So this just to give you some number of, in general, the Earth observation market, because it's now a market. According to the London Economics, as you can see, this market was worth 40 billion in 2017, will be 56, so a huge increase in just 3 years' time. As I mentioned, the Earth observation, the predominant use, there's a mistake here, I should have said, of satellite data is for meteorology. As you can see, almost 90% of the product are used there in that sector. And essentially, specifically, for example, the case of the UK, but this is something that can be easily applied to other countries. You can see this was a report published in 2018. It was expected by 2020 that heat would have trebled its direct value. So it's a growing market, a lot of opportunity, not just in Earth observation, but for research, but also for commercial companies. And this is, of course, this means that there is a huge amount of satellite data. So now I'm going to talk specifically of satellites. As you can see, there is a huge amount of satellite data. And of course, sometimes it could be tricky to understand which one we are going to use. So I put here this what is called a satellite decision tree, where essentially we can decide, because of the vast variety of satellite data, what type of satellite we want to use. Of course, the main question is always about money. So we have to start here at some point, see, are we willing to spend money? For this course, the answer is no. So it will be an easy solution. And we are, because we are going to use also produce Langkover map for regional scale studies, we don't need a huge detail. So we don't need resolution of 1 meter or in that range. So for us, Sentinel-2, it's useful enough. But of course, there are, if we are willing to spend money, use greater resolution, better resolution, as you can see, there is a plenty of satellite provider, which of course they come at a cost. It's important we say that we, for the application, we are going to use Langkover map. Usually, we use free satellite data. But it's important to know that this satellite data can become very expensive for if we need high resolution data from commercial provider, which of course they will provide, they will allow us to do to bring the science in our case to a higher level, so to provide even much more details. But let's stay to the free satellite data. So the European Space Agency has created this Earth Observation Program called Copernicus. It's a list of, as you can see, 7 satellites. They are twins for each of these 6 constellations. There are 2 satellites. So there will be Sentinel-1A, 1B, and the same for Sentinel-2A, 2B, and so on. They all cover, some of them, they cover the same interval of the electromagnetic waves. So I put here the number versus the electromagnetic spectrum, the satellite, sorry, versus the electromagnetic spectrum. And as you can see, some of them, for example, Sentinel-2, Sentinel-5P, or Sentinel-3, they overlap in terms of wavelength, but they have different scope. Okay, so in particular, for example, if we go on the ESA website, you will find all the information about all the other satellites, but we are going to focus just on Sentinel-2. So Sentinel-2 is multispectral imaging mission for land monitoring. Okay, so this is important. There will be also other, I think Sentinel-3 is again a multispectral, but for sea analysis, sea monitoring. Sentinel-2 instead is just for analyzing vegetation, soil, water cover, coastal area, that's it. It was launched in 2015, the first Sentinel-2A, and then the brother was launched in March 2017. So there are 2 satellites now orbiting and acquiring data. So now forget about all the other satellites, it's just will be Sentinel-2. At 13 bands, you can see represented here the Sentinel-2 multispectral imaging bands according to the wavelength. As you can see, this is the atmospheric transmission, which can be affected, of course, from the atmosphere and the cloud coverage. So you can see that the atmospheric transmission in the blue, green, and red, so the visible spectrum is not the maximum possible. And as you can see, it's important that we have like 13 bands spanning across the visible, near infrared, and shortwave infrared. So we are going essentially to use bands in the visible and near infrared for our exercise. But also because another big problem is, for example, if we use band blue, green, red, and also band number 8 in the near infrared, they have a resolution of 10 meters. But there are other bands where essentially there is, for the same amount of pixel size, there is less energy available. So we need a larger area, okay, to analyze. So we'll have essentially a coarser resolution. So this is the reason why There are other bands, 1, 5, 6, which have a worse resolution from 20 to 60 meter. And this is a comparison of Sentinel-2 with other satellites, so Landsat 8, for example. And as you can see, the important the bands of Sentinel-2 have been built essentially in a way that they could overlap with some of the Landsat 8. So this will allow, this will make easier any comparison across the year and between the two sensors. So this is important. So even new satellites, they are built in the way that the band's wavelength, the central band wavelengths correspond to the previous satellite mission. So we'll make easier any comparison. And of course, to give you an idea, Sentinel data, Sentinel-2 data, there are different levels which this, so we acquire these multispectral images, okay? And in particular, there are different levels. So, for example, we have, if we go on the ESA website and type Sentinel-2, we have, of course, preview data. So we just have an overview of the product of the image. That's it. This is just to give an idea of the user of how it looks like the image. But once we download, in addition to this, if we focus, in addition to this, we always have, regardless of the level, 0, 1A, 1B, 1C, we always have also ancillary data with the satellite telemetry. So it's telling us essentially when it's been acquired, the image, for how long, the auxiliary data, which are very important when we have to do some pre-processing, we will see later. So all information about the sun, for example, elevation angle for that time of the acquisition, and also some geometric and image properties. So we have all this information regardless of the level, but of course there is a big difference. So level 0, 1A, 1B, we are not going to use that. They detect essentially what are called, the footprint is called granules, and they are a zoom image essentially of the actual image acquired. And they are very small sub images of 25 meter in 25 kilometers, sorry, in size, 25 by 23, something like that. But they are not made available for users. They are just for the ESA scientists to analyze the data. We instead working usually with, we download the level 1C or 2A. These are the data available also on Google Earth Engine. So in these products, for example, the image is divided in 100 by 100 kilometer tiles in UTM projection system. So that is the area investigated. The difference is essentially that level 1C are radiometric and geometrically corrected top of atmosphere. We will later show what is this top of atmosphere product. While, for example, level 2 product, so the latest, the highest level available, are bottom of atmosphere. So essentially, top of atmosphere is the reflectance, we considering also the atmosphere, while 2A represent the bottom, so essentially the reflectance from the Earth itself, without removing the influence of the atmosphere. So this is just to give you an idea of how the granules, so the product combined in the, at this stage, 1A, 1B, is then, they are combined essentially to create the tiles. So the tiles are the product, the 100 by 100 kilometers products that we analyze, we have access to, okay? But essentially, yeah, they are a combination of different granules. That's it. Okay, so when we access, so we download the image, this is important. This Sentinel-2 image have a long, long name. It's probably 27 character, but there is all the information already. Even, yeah, from the name itself, we know everything we need, because this will tell us if it's Sentinel-2A, 2B. It's a very blurry image, so I hope you can see enough. This is essentially, yes, telling if it's operative or testing. So it's essentially I think the first months of the mission usually it's operational, so it's just a test. Yeah, there are preliminary images which were released. I think all the products now they come with upper label. The beginning you could have the option for tests at the beginning of each satellite mission. This is the level I was saying before. So usually we are getting access to 1C or 2A. And then we have information about the time when the image was acquired, also the relative orbit number, which is important because this will make us understand where are we in the Earth globe, so the position. And yeah, the starting and ending time of the image. That's it. Okay, so now just, I think this is the end of this first presentation, just to give you an idea of the different resolution we are working with. So we need to consider the difference between spatial, temporal, radiometric, and spectral. This, going through this, the explanation of all these different resolution, we will understand also with which product we are dealing with. So essentially, spatial resolution was the area and how detailed. So as you can see, spatial resolution is the minimum distance at which the sensor can discriminate between two closer scatterers. So as you can see, let's say these are the same, the scatterers, okay? These are represented in a different way, but it's the same concept. So these are in the row here, three different resolutions. So the same scatterer, this is with the full resolution, how they are, and this is with two sensors. As you can see, if they have this as a coarse resolution, so you see the distance between the minimum distance between the two scatterers is which can be distinguished, it's much smaller. This is a worse resolution compared to this and to this. Different from, so the resolution is the minimum distance the sensor can discriminate, and as you can see, this is a much better resolution than these other two. The spacing instead is different. Usually people use as a synonymous, but they are actually different. Pixel spacing indeed is much easier. It's just what's the size of the pixel to meters in the real world to the ground. So as you can see, this pixel spacing is 1 inch. We have 1 pixel. This for the same inch, so the same space, we have 2 pixel resolution. Here we have 4 pixel resolution, and this here instead 8 pixel resolution. What does it mean? So that if we have an object here, you can see with that we can have a better understanding of the age of it. Okay, so the resolution depends on the antenna characteristics, while the pixel spacing actually can be changed. Okay, we can essentially change it. So for example, we can decide from this pixel resolution, we have, with this 30 by 30, we can decide to decrease, to, for example, reduce the size of the image. We can decide, because probably the object is so big, we can still define it with a low pixel spacing. We can redefine to 20 by 20 pixel, for example. So the pixel spacing is decided by us. The resolution, no, it's depending from the sensor itself. If we see across the Earth, okay, this is the satellite launches per year, and this is the mean spatial resolution. So as you can see, the resolution has been steadily increasing in time. So as you can see now, the on average, we have a resolution of, we are around 20, 30 meters, 10 meters, if we consider the old satellite available. And this is just to give you an example. This is London, this is the River Thames, this is central London, this is Tower Hamlets. Here, there will be in 2000 build the O2 Arena, where they do a lot of concerts. I don't know if you have been there. So this is from 1975, resolution of, we're talking around 60 meter, 60 by 80 meter, lens at one. This is the same area now. So it's another world, of course, a lot of time in between. So almost 40 years, more than 40 years. Around 40 years, but 10 meter resolution difference. So you could see the difference. Of course, a lot of changes in the between, but still you can see you can do a completely different application with the same area because you have much better resolution. But as I said before, usually better resolution come at the expense of the footprint. So as you can see, coarse resolution, like for lens data, it means we can cover a higher area, a larger area, sorry. If we go and, for example, pay for high resolution data, spot, for example, QuickBird, you see 2.5 pixel resolution, we can get, of course, better resolution, but a very small area. So these are commercial providers, usually are something that we pay for analyzing that small area where we already know what's the main focus of our research. The main spot of our research, because they are very costly. We are talking about thousands of pounds for each image. Temporal resolution. So temporal resolution is essentially how many acquisitions we have in time. As you can see, this is just to give you an idea. Usually, free data are good because they have a huge temporal interval, okay? So it means that, yeah, we can do multi-temporal studies and change. For example, in the case of free data from Landsat, we can go back to 1972. Of course, the temporal resolution, this is the temporal interval. But now, while, for example, in the 70, we probably have this area one image per year. Now, the temporal resolution is probably one every 5 days, okay, with the free data, free satellite data. So this is just to give you an idea. And now for the, as of essentially last week, for the Hanoi province, we have around 4,000 Landsat images. But of course, Landsat image is starting from the 70s. And only in last 5 years, we have essentially only from Sentinel-2 more than 1,200 images. So it means that, the temporal resolution in time has increased hugely. And this is, just an example from Hanoi. So probably, and the expansion of the city between, 1984 and 2019. I'm going almost to the end, so don't worry. Temporal resolution, of course, temporal resolution, it means we are comparing stuff from different time, even from the same sensor. It's important at that point. Of course, probably for large scale application is not that important, but for a smaller area, it's important that when we compare image acquired at different time, they overlap. So we have what is called the co-registration. So we need to align this pixel. So for example, this gray pixel here should correspond to this black pixel in the second image. So it's important we align this image before we're doing any comparison in time. Co-registration ensures that the image essentially are aligned. So any feature in one image corresponds to the other. Usually, to be honest, especially with Sentinel-2, co-registration error are usually 1/10 of the pixel spacing. So to be honest, it means that we are talking about meters, maximum 1-2 meters of misalignment, which is good enough. But of course, once we have these images aligned, stacked all together, this is important. Why it could be so important having a good temporal resolution, high temporal resolution, because like our land cover map, we can detect for the same area different phenologic states. So in this case is essentially an example of the wheat in the US. You could see that essentially it grows during April, June, so in spring. This means that essentially if we are looking with satellite data, this type of land cover, we will have a different response for this time of the year. So this is a good point if we want to monitor it. Phenological type. So for this, we have a huge application in agriculture from land cover map. This is another example. Again, another type of vegetation, cattails and water lilies in South Carolina. Again, you can see that when they are green, of course, it will mean there will be like a different color in our satellite imagery. And this happens during spring and summertime, while during winter and autumn, we have brown. So the same pixel will appear brown. This is a third example again, So essentially, when the vegetation is green and healthy, we have a different Lankover response, okay? And this is important because this will affect essentially how it looks like the image. And this is radiometric resolution. So radiometric resolution, essentially, to detect the radiometric resolution, this is important because essentially we will work with products that have been radiometrically corrected. So essentially, we, even when we download the 1C products, okay, or 2B products, so the top, regardless the top of atmosphere or bottom of atmosphere, let's say the example, like in this case, is top of atmosphere, we, when we see the satellite data, we have, if we download it, a digital number, okay? So it's just essentially, yeah, sensitivity of that pixel. We need to come, we cannot still, that number, of course, is related to the reflectance of the surface, but we need to get that number, reflectance, do some work on it. So we need to convert the digital number with the sensor radiance with the information provided in the auxiliary data. So this information are all in that big folder we download. So we convert to radiance of the sensor. Then we took information about the solar elevation, the solar angle, sun distance, and we translate to top of atmosphere, okay? And then eventually we can also do an atmospheric correction and get the surface reflectance. So we get this when we download the data, but we have all the information, the auxiliary data to retrieve the top of atmosphere and bottom of atmosphere. In the end, we get a number. So for example, the digital number of Sentinel-2 is 12 bit. So it means that essentially the pixel range can, brightness can range between 0 and 4,000. This is very important because it means we have much more capability to detect the different, okay, level of brightness. It means much higher capability to detect different objects. While Landsat-2, for example, was just 8-bit. So the potential range of brightness was much limited. And this is just, so this is now regardless of resolution, okay, of pixel spacing. You can see that the same image with different bits, so different radiometric resolution, will provide much more details because 1 bit is just 2-level, black and white. But it means that here with 8-bit, for example, we can have much more information. Almost at the end, so don't worry. Then we will have a break. So and now, so that was the radiometric. So essentially, yeah, the sensitivity for each pixel. This is the spectral resolution. Spectral, so we are now looking at the, essentially how wide is the wavelength. So how wide, for example, is this band 8, and wide, I mean wide in terms of electromagnetic waves. So is an ability of resolve features in the electromagnetic spectrum. This is important because these are the wavelength range, essentially 400 to 50 to 520 for the blue, for example. So these are all the spectral resolution. Why they are important? Because I will bring you to the next slide. Essentially, when we do Lankover class, we look at the different spectrum, okay? So it means if we have a wider spectral resolution, we can detect, it's like a footprint, we can detect better this difference. This is, the different spectrum of reflectance from vegetation, lake water, soil. As you can see, if we have just a line here, for example, in this case, we don't see the difference between this brown and green line. But if we have a larger spectral resolution, so as an interval, we can detect this difference, for example. So it's important because the spectral signature can be used, it's used essentially for detect and classify the materials. If we have more bands, if we have larger bands, we have much higher capability to detect these different surfaces. And so, just to compare Landsat sensor with Sentinel-2, so why I'm so keen to use Sentinel-2, because if we want to eventually compare Sentinel-2, which they started only in 2015 with the Landsat, of course, we have to consider all different, consider this different resolution. We have to do a band adjustment because they will have probably a slightly different spectral resolution, a rescaling because they will have definitely a different spatial resolution, and co-registration because they have to be essentially bring to the same reference frame. So these are, so we will just compare Sentinel-2 data with Sentinel-2 data. So we don't need to care about this processing, but this is something we need to account if we want to compare different satellite, different sensor. So just to summarize, for this is for the exercise we are going to do. Essentially, we are working with 10 meter resolution in, yeah, essentially in red, green, blue, and also band 8 spectrum, which cover an area of 100 by 100 kilometers. They have a temporal resolution of 5 days at the Vietnam latitudes and also the Philippines latitude. They have a radiometric resolution of 12 bits. So it means that the pixel range would be between 0 and 4,000. But with Google Earth Engine, we can already convert this to a reflectance value. And in terms of band, we have, in general, we have about 13 bands. 10 are the main one, the one we are going to use, also because we are going to do the classification with the 10 meter pixel size spacing, but actually we are going to use other, and we will see later when we will do the exercise, we are using other bands to remove some of the clouds interference. So that was it. So if you have any question, I will stop sharing now. I hope it was not boring. But this is just, yeah, a general overview. So happy to take question now. Or eventually we can have this 15 minutes break and we can start to see how this data is used for a Landcover mapping. So let me know, I mean, if you want to write eventually in the, I will stop recording. If you want to write in the